I've started working on my marine engineering thesis, which I wanted to write about KOGAS propulsion at first. And KOGAS is an abbreviation for combined gas and steam turbine. And I have started work with a small trial thesis to sort of get into the process of how to write it and how to do things, and then decided to abandon the topic in favor for a comparison of LNG and methanol fuel for reasons which I'm going to explain at the end of the video because I want to go straight into topic. And yeah, before we get to KOGAS, we will have to go around the topic a bit to lead to it. And this is going to be quite a long video because of all of this, but you can I have placed bookmarks in the timeline of the video to help you skip things if you already know them or just are impatient. So anyway, we will start with the introduction about some basics of KOGAS. Then some basics about gas turbines, some basics about steam, which we both sort of need to know to get to the topic of KOGAS, and some land-based combined cycle power plants, which are very similar to KOGAS propulsion and are used since decades, and conventional gas turbine ships and diesel-electric propulsion. And then for the actual KOGAS topic, we will discuss the advantages and disadvantages of KOGAS. Then a conclusion where it makes sense, where it doesn't make sense, and two potential applications with the perfect LNG concept and the repowering of LNG tankers. And on the right side, you can see a basic drawing of the very basic principle of KOGAS propulsion, of the combination of a gas turbine at the bottom and a steam turbine on top of it. We get to all of this. I have added a few extra slides because the visual part of this video is just taken from the presentation which I held in my school as sort of showing my results, and of course there I could take some basic knowledge about marine propulsion for granted, which I cannot do on YouTube obviously. So as you may know, ships usually are powered by diesel engines in a variety of arrangements. And on cargo ships, which make up the vast majority of the global fleet, these can either be a pitch propeller or controllable pitch propeller with a reduction gearbox, usually before a four-stroke engine. And this allows to have the engine running at a constant speed and then just change your thrust and the direction of the thrust by changing the pitch of the propeller blades. But this only works up to a certain size. And above of that, you have just a fixed pitch propeller, which is directly, literally bolted to the flywheel of your engine. And because you need engines that are very slow and have very high torque, these engines are two-stroke diesel engines, very large ones with very long stroke. And on passenger ships, you often have a similar arrangement to the first one, but with two four-stroke diesel engines driving a shaft with a pitch propeller, just so you can fit smaller engines, which are not as high as one larger one, so you have more usable space on top of the engine room. And especially on cruise ships, diesel-electric propulsion is also very common, where you have large generators which feed the entire electric demand on board. And then you use frequency converters for the propeller motors, because of course these motors are AC motors, and the speed of them is controlled with the frequency of the current of your alternating current. And yeah, I did a bit of visualization with this picture of such a large two-stroke engine on board of the ship where I used to be a cadet. And in the top right corner, you can see a video of that engine room with many explanations. And generally, if you are interested in this marine engineering stuff, I upload videos on that every now and then, so you can feel free to subscribe. And I also recommend you to ring the notification bell to get notified about personal content, because I upload videos on a large variety of topics. So anyway, here's another picture which puts this very long stroke of such two-stroke engines really into perspective, where you can actually see how long the stroke is, which then produces this slow RPM and insane torque. Then for passenger ships, here's an engine room with two inline four-stroke engines, which probably drive a shaft, because I don't see, or I cannot see, where you could fit a generator there. Then for this diesel-electric propulsion, they often use large V engines with 12, 16, sometimes even 20 cylinders, than some very large high voltage generators driven by these engines. For the actual introduction into KOGAS, as I already have said, it is a combination of gas and steam turbines, where essentially the steam turbines recover waste heat from the gas turbine exhaust gas with waste heat or exhaust gas boilers. And if you use this with electric power transmission, it is called KOGAS for combined gas and steam turbine electric. And the overall efficiency of such a plant can equal the efficiency of diesel engines, because gas turbines usually are significantly less efficient than diesel engines, as they use a as they lose a lot of waste heat with the hot exhaust gas. And one of the advantages of such a plant is that, or the advantage over conventional diesel diesel propulsion, is that it can use LNG or methanol. So has improved utilization of alternative fuels such as LNG or methanol, which leads to less emissions, and also less emissions compared to a diesel engine running on these fuels. And this, this principle has been used for decades in land-based combined cycle power plants. So we have this picture, again, this drawing from 2 minutes ago, where you can see at number one in brown are the generators, which are driven by the steam turbine, at number two in light blue, and the exhaust steam then goes to the number three, a condenser, where it is condensed back to water, which then is fed with the boiler water feed pump, at number four back into the boiler, at number five, and then number six again in light blue is the gas turbine. And this is, for some reason, they have numbered it in exactly the opposite direction as I would have found it logical, because I would have started with the gas turbine and then went on to the generators at last. Turbines are most commonly used in the aviation industry, where they power most, if not all, airliners today. And they do this mostly in the form of turbofan engines, which commonly are called jet engines. And one of them you can see here right now, it is a Rolls-Royce Trent, whatever the number is. And the actual gas turbine is the smaller thing on the left. I don't know if you can see my mouse, but I hope you can do. And it doesn't provide so much thrust, but mostly drives the turbofan, or ducted propeller is another name for it, here on the right side with the much larger diameter. And this thing then provides most of the thrust. And basics about gas turbines include that they convert chemical energy to mechanical work, and do so by the principle of compression, combustion, and expansion, just like an internal combustion or piston engine does, like a diesel engine. But unlike them, they do it in a continuous process instead of this intermittent steps in a cylinder. And to do so, they are fluid machines, unlike the pistons, which displace the gases in the cylinders of a diesel engine. And compared to diesel engines, gas turbines are lighter and more compact, and often are derived from aviation, or from aviation engines. And all of this is very similar to the turbocharger, which of course is, I included this because everybody in my marine engineering class is familiar with turbochargers, and this makes things really a lot easier to imagine if you are familiar with them. But this thing here actually is not a turbocharger. It looks very similar and it works very similar, but it is a turbopump from a rocket engine. But generally, there's a lot more in common between marine engineering and rocket engineering than one may think. Now for the function of a gas turbine, here's a simple basic drawing, where you have to imagine it without the fan, the very large green thing on the left, and instead just place a gearbox which drives the machine or generator, whatever you want. But essentially, the gas flows through it from left to right, where it gets compressed, and then fuel is injected and burned in the combustion chamber, which heats the gas, and then this expanding gases drive the turbine, which then drives the compressor and the machinery that you want to drive with the gas turbine. And here it is written again with the compressor, combustion chamber, and turbine. All of this works on with rotating blades, be it compressor blades or turbine blades, and they have the static blades or stator blades from the guide vanes in between them. And in the combustion chamber, fuel is injected and burned, and all of this leads to severe mechanical and thermal stress from the centrifugal forces caused by the high rotational speeds, by the high RPM, And of course, the thermal stress in the compressor just from compression heat, and then in the combustion chamber and in the turbine from the fuel flames from the combustion process. And to deal with all of this thermal stress, the gas turbines use film cooling, where air is injected into the turbine and then provides a small layer of cold air between the hot gases of the or the hot gas flow from the compressor, which is heated from the compression, or then the hot gases from the combustion chamber. And because of this film cooling, the gas turbine, or a lot more gas passes through the gas turbine than is actually needed to burn the fuel. So they produce much more exhaust gas given for a given power rating than a diesel engine. And this exhaust gas typically is also is hotter, which of course causes this these large losses due to the waste heat, and then allows to heat boilers with it. And exhaust gas leaves at a relatively high pressure, especially compared to a steam turbine, which then, of course, is interesting to us because the boilers provide an obstruction in the exhaust gas flow. And then, yeah, multi-shaft turbines, I will talk about that in a minute when we get the according drawing. But here you can see these either turbine or compressor blade, which has the small holes through which the air leaves, which then provides this film cooling. And of course, before it gets to the holes, the air also cools the compressor blade from inside. Here's another drawing of a, or another cutaway picture of a yeah, small jet turbine from for model airplanes. And this thin yellow line, once again, I hope you can see my mouse, actually shows how it there's more air injected into the combustion chamber, which then provides this film cooling and keeps the hot flames away from the walls of the combustion chamber. Then there's the drawing, once again, which we already had a minute ago and which I mentioned, because this multi-shaft means that there is one shaft connecting the low pressure compressor with the low pressure turbine, and then in purple another shaft which connects the high pressure turbine with the high pressure compressor, which spins faster. And some jet engine or some turbofan engines, like this Rolls-Royce Trent in the beginning, even are triple shaft engines, which then have another gearbox between the low pressure or between the low pressure shaft and the fan in the at the front of the engine to make it spin even slower, which of course is useful for the gas turbines that we would use on ships, because generally we need much slower RPM, much slower speeds. Of gas turbines include a good power to weight and power to size ratio, so they are small and lightweight while still being very powerful. And because of the continuous combustion, they have less emissions than diesel engines, as diesel engines always have very high peak temperatures in or temperature spikes at each ignition, which cause a lot of nitric oxide emissions. And also this intermittent combustion causes soot and other particulate emissions, which can be cut down by burning LNG or methanol as alternative fuel, and then can be cut even more when burning them in gas turbines instead. And also, talking about LNG and emissions, gas turbines have almost no methane slip, which basically means that when burning LNG, you always have some LNG going into, or some methanol, which makes up the majority of LNG, and you always have some which escapes through the exhaust gas unburned. And methane is a much stronger greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. So the methane slip in a diesel engine, especially in a four-stroke diesel, offsets all your other environmental benefits. And with gas turbines, it can be limited, or it can be reduced to almost zero. And talking about LNG or alternative fuels like LNG or methanol, they also have the advantage in gas turbines that you don't need pilot fuel, because LNG or methanol cannot self-ignite from compression heat, so the diesel principle doesn't really work with them, and you always have to inject a bit of diesel oil as pilot fuel, which then ignites the LNG or the methanol. And you don't have to do that in gas turbines, as they ignite only once when you start them up, and then they just keep burning. And what is interesting for, or most interesting mostly for passenger vessels, is the reduction in vibrations and noise emissions. But they can also become important for other ships, as this also means less emissions of that kind into the water, but I will talk about that later. And the disadvantages of gas turbines are mostly about money, because gas turbines are less efficient than diesel engines. And I have prepared this little comparison between the MAN 6S80 ME-C9, I think it's actually 9.0, which I experienced in my time as a cadet. It is the large engine that you have seen before. And excuse me, GE or General Electric LM 2500 marine gas turbine, which there are various versions of it, like this set of numbers and letters in the MAN 6S80. But I'm not so familiar with them, so I just called it GE LM 2500. And it is, I think it is the most common or one of the most common marine gas turbines. And essentially, the MAN diesel engine has efficiency of 164.4 grams of fuel per kilowatt hour at 27,060 kilowatts, which means, or this is called specific consumption, and it means that for every kilowatt, you have this fuel consumption in grams per hour. And yeah, if you are not so familiar with that, it means about around 55% efficiency, which makes it the well, one of the most efficient internal combustion engines in the world. And the General Electric gas turbine has a specific consumption of 230.9 grams per kilowatt hour at 22,400 kilowatts. So they are about the same power. And if we then translate this efficiency to percent, which I guess most people are more familiar with, it means that it is around 35% efficient. So this is a yeah, it's a major difference in fuel efficiency. And what is important too is the higher acquisition cost than diesel engines, because gas turbines use more expensive materials as they are constantly exposed to the hot gas and generally have to withstand greater thermal stresses, which makes them significantly more important than significantly more expensive than diesel engines. And another thing is that gas turbines, like almost all turbines, minus some water turbines, run at high speeds and low torques, which is the exact opposite of what you want for a ship propeller. So you would require large reduction gearboxes. And two more disadvantages is the high air consumption, which of course requires according engine room ventilation systems. And they generally require better fuel quality than diesel engines, because there are some gas turbines that can run on heavy fuel oil, like most marine engines do, but most cannot, especially the ones that are derived from aviation engines. And then finally, for gas turbines, I have a picture of such a industrial gas turbine that can be applied for ship propulsion. And this is a Siemens engine, and because Siemens doesn't produce aviation engines, this is really built for the purpose of industrial applications. The basics about steam into the two topics of steam production and steam turbines. And if you're interested in steam tech, I can also recommend you some of my other videos. Once again, you can access them with the card in the top right corner. But anyway, in steam production, you always transfer heat to the boiler water. And in combined gas and steam applications, the temperatures are lower than in conventional boilers with a furnace, because the exhaust gas from the gas turbines, while being hot, still is way colder than the flame of a burner. And to make do with that smaller temperature difference, in combined gas and steam applications, that you often use multi-stage boiler arrangements, where essentially you have a lower pressure boiler and a high pressure boiler, sometimes even an intermediate pressure boiler in between. And between these boilers, the boiler water is pumped with a booster pump. And if all of that is a bit hard to imagine, which I expect, you can in a minute see a drawing which I made on that. And other features that are typical for every boiler is an economizer, which preheats the feed water. and a superheater, which heats steam beyond the saturation temperature, and then all of that in the bottom we are just going to explain with this superb drawing which I made, because I couldn't find what I was looking for. I couldn't find it online, and I'm not good with computer animations and CAD, etc. But essentially, once again, I hope you can see my mouse. The exhaust gas leaves the gas turbine at the bottom and then passes the superheater, the high pressure boiler, the low pressure boiler, and the feed water preheater. Or, which is easier to imagine, the boiler feed water comes from the feed water re reservoir, excuse me, reservoir tank, and is pumped with the feed water pump. Pumped to the pressure of the low pressure boiler, but still at the temperature of the reservoir tank. And then the feed water preheater already heats it beyond 100 degrees Celsius, where it would usually start to boil. But of course, it is at a higher pressure, so it cannot boil. And then is pumped into the low pressure boiler, where it gets boiled, or where it gets boiled at a pressure of, I don't know, maybe 7 bar, 10 bar, something like that. And then gets pumped with a booster pump to the high pressure boiler, where it gets boiled to typical turbine pressures of 20 and more bar. And from that, in purple, is the saturated steam, which then goes further down right next to the turbine, where the temp ga exhaust gas is the hottest, and where the superheater superheats the steam, which means vaporizing all the small water droplets that still are in the saturated steam. And from there, the superheated steam can be brought to the turbine. So essentially, you have, in that way, the pressure temperature of the exhaust gas decreasing, and in that way, the pressure and mostly the temperature of the feed water or the steam increasing. Turbines work pretty much the same way as the turbine in a gas turbine, which means transforming temperature and pressure into mechanical energy, which I actually explained in a little more detail in my actual presentation in the school, but I really cut short the bit about explaining gas turbines. But anyway, unlike gas, the turbine in a gas turbine, a steam turbine is not cooled, because in steam machines you always want to conserve as much temperature in them as possible. And unlike gas turbines, they can expand into a vacuum, into pressures below the atmospheric pressure of 1 bar, by cooling the exhaust steam in the condenser, which then lowers the pressure. And because of this lower pressure, it is also possible to maintain steam at temperatures below 100 degrees Celsius. And then, just to visualize that, you already had a picture in the last slide. And here is another one, although this kind of steam turbine obviously is more the stationary power plant type. You will never ever see such a huge machine in a onboard a ship. Power plants, we are now at the topic of land-based combined cycle gas and steam power plants, which have been used since decades and work pretty much the same way as KOGAS propulsion on ships, which has been used only once about 20 years ago. And they can reach efficiencies of up to 65%, which makes them the second most efficient type of power plant after hydropower. And with heating supply, efficiency can even be increased to about 85%, which means that you basically take some steam and then use it to deliver heat to homes. And combined cycle gas and steam power plants can be arranged as single shaft or multi shaft, which, unlike single shaft or multi shaft in gas turbines, means that you can have the gas turbine or gas turbines and the steam turbines going onto one generator with a gearbox, which then goes onto the generator shaft, or you can have separate generators for each turbine. And multi shaft is simpler but also less efficient, because, of course, two generators are less efficient than one bigger one, but it is much simpler than essentially starting the gas turbine when the steam turbine isn't running, because there isn't any heat going to it or any steam. And because of that, they are medium load power plants, unlike pure gas turbine power plants, which can be started very quickly. So they are used as peak load power plants. But similarly, they can be started fast enough that they don't have to be used as baseload power plants. I have got this drawing of such a combined cycle power plant, which I did not translate to English because essentially you can see the large gas turbine on the left, which then provides the hot steam with the red pipes to the steam turbines, which also recirculates once to the boiler where it is superheated again. And then there is electricity supplied from the green generator and transformer to the home on the right, and you can also see the heating being supplied to the home. And if you like to see what these things actually look like, you can see this picture here with the gas turbines in these boxes on the right hand side. They are in these boxes for noise reduction. And then the hot exhaust gas goes to these large boilers behind them, which probably are triple stage boilers. And from them, the steam goes to the turbine in this large building a bit left to it. And behind of that, the large thing are the radiators for the cooling water from the condenser. And then at the bottom, you can see the two transformers. Conventional gas turbine ships, which because of the characteristics of gas turbines, usually have them in some kind of combined plant. And talking about combined plants, COSAC, which means combined steam and gas turbines, is not not to be confused with COGAS, because in COSAC you have a conventional steam turbine plant with boilers and then gas turbines to supplement it, to give it a boost, but without any kind of waste heat recovery. And common combined plants today are CODOC for combined diesel or gas turbine and CODAC for combined diesel and gas turbine. And in CODOC, or both of them have in common that you use the efficient diesel engines for cruising and then the gas turbine for high speeds. CODOC, you switch off the diesel engines when you reach high speeds, and in CODAC you keep them on, you keep them running, which means you are not hauling them around as dead weight, but it comes with the problem that you have to mix the completely different characteristics of slow diesel engines with much torque and much more powerful, but mostly in the form of speed gas turbine with a complicated set of clutches and gearboxes. And I would love actually to see such a thing. And because of that, I'm hoping for one of the Augsburg class frigates of the German navies, which are currently being decommissioned, to be preserved as as a museum ship. Because of course, such complicated things are limited to ships where you need this combination of slow cruising and then reaching high speeds without much care for efficiency, which mostly is limited to military ships like frigates. These gas turbine plants have in common that they require powerful engine room ventilation systems because of the high air consumption of gas turbines. And another problem is that gas turbines are sensitive to corrosion from these large unprotected metal surfaces on the inside, which are completely blank metal and not protected by a layer of lubrication oil, so not like a diesel engine. And of course, corrosion is something that you really have to worry about at sea. And pure gas turbine propulsion is rare and mostly limited to ships which really need high power all the time, like some fast ferries like catamarans, or also hovercrafts, which technically are considered as ships, or aircraft carriers, which basically go fast all the time. And this Queen Elizabeth class aircraft carrier here from the Royal Navy uses two 36 megawatt Marine Trent 800, I think it's a Marine Trent 800, gas turbines from Rolls-Royce in a, well, gas turbine electric plant. They try to find a very small engine room on the lowest deck of this ship. There are two engine rooms. You can really see how tiny the space is that in which you can squeeze 72 megawatts, which is about the same power as the Maersk Triple E class of container ships. It was twice the largest container ship in the world, or the largest class of container ships, and has about the same power, but essentially the engine room is about the entire hull below the two funnels at the stern. Electric propulsion obviously is pretty much the same as diesel electric propulsion, just with a different prime mover. And I've mentioned before that cruise ships often use diesel electric propulsion, where, as mentioned before, diesel engines drive generators. And you then have the choice if you have separate diesel generators for your propulsion and separate diesel generators for the remaining shipboard consumption, like engine room machinery, deck machinery, or the accommodations. And Or you can have just large diesel generators which power everything. And the latter also is caused integrated electric propulsion. And there you need frequency converters for speed regulation because, of course, you want to maintain a constant frequency in your normal shipboard grid, but also have to regulate the speed of your propeller motors by regulating the frequency because these are AC motors, which where the speed depends on the frequency. And the advantage of, or one of the advantages of diesel electric propulsion is that it is more efficient at slow speeds, because essentially you can have multiple diesel generators, as shown in this graphic here, where the full line shows diesel electric propulsion, and then the short dotted line diesel mechanical propulsion with only one engine, like you typically find in cargo ships, or the longer dotted line shows. Excuse me, I made a mistake. The short dotted line shows the diesel mechanic propulsion with two engines per propeller, like you can find on many ferries or some cruise ships. And then the long dotted line shows the diesel mechanic propulsion or the direct diesel propulsion, like as you can find on cargo ships with just one large engine. And essentially, this you can always see a very low drop in the specific consumption where the engines run at their most efficient load, which is around 80% of their load or 85%. So the direct propulsion is most efficient at 85% load or 85% of the maximum power. And the diesel mechanical propulsion with two engines with the short dotted line actually has 2 points of very efficient load, one at around 40% and then the other again at 85. And the diesel electric propulsion has four of these points where you have one generator running at the most efficient load, two generators, three, and then four generators at the most efficient load. Which of course is great for cruise ships because they have a relatively high electric consumption for the for all the hotel and all this whatever kind of fun devices they use. I don't know, I don't care about such stuff. And but doesn't really make sense on cargo ships mostly. And another thing which is interesting for us with the gas turbines is the efficiency of this electric transmission, because of course you essentially have the on the left-hand side you have the shaft of your prime mover, which can be a diesel engine or a gas turbine or a steam turbine, generator, the main switchboard, supply transformer, frequency converter, and the propulsion motor. Because I'm not going into too much detail why you need all of these for relatively complex electrical reasons, but essentially you can see that this has an overall efficiency shaft to shaft of 90 to 92.3%. And if we then look at typical industrial gas turbine and industrial steam turbine speeds of 3000 RPM, 3600 RPM, depending on the frequency of the generator, this thing is way more efficient than a mechanical gearbox, which reduces these speeds to typical propeller speeds of 75 to 150 RPM. Of diesel electric thing, which is about the closest to Kogas and Kogas you can get, and that has actually been built in significant numbers and not just four ships, which I'm going to mention in a minute, is using exhaust gas boilers to reclaim waste heat from diesel engines and then use it to drive turbines. Because it just occurred to me that another thing that I took for granted is that on it is very common on cargo ships to have exhaust gas boilers and then reclaim waste heat in the form of steam and use it for shipboard heating, like of the accommodation, of the heavy fuel oil piping, or also for freshwater production. But on large ships with 12 or more cylinders, like the Maersk Triple E class, which we've seen a minute ago, which actually has 16 cylinders and two engines, and these may produce so much waste heat that there just isn't enough consumption for all this steam. And then you can use some multi-stage boiler plants, like I've described before, and drive steam turbine generators with them. And ship about well, the type of ship where I found the most about such plants is the MR Maersk class, which was again the largest container ship in the world in 2007, and yeah, uses a small steam turbine and then some shaft motors to feed this electricity back to the shaft and increase the total propulsive efficiency. And this plant also allows to keep the diesel generators at their most efficient load. And the Maersk Triple E class, which we've seen before, uses a similar system where the generators also, or the shaft motors also double as shaft generators. So you could also feed power from the more efficient main engine into the electrical grid, depending on your load, which varies on a lot of things. But I'm not going into too much detail with that because that would just blow the scope of the video. Informations. We can now draw our KOGAS, or in this case KOGES, arrangement plan, where we have the gas turbine in many colors at the bottom left. I realized in the meantime that you cannot see my mouse, so I have to describe everything. And it is fueled by boil-off gas at the very bottom left, which is cargo from an LNG, or generally from a gas tanker, which vaporized over time because the liquefied gases have to be supercooled to cryogenic temperatures, and some of it vaporizes and you then use it in your engines. And essentially some of that plus marine gas oil, right of it, MGO, is burned in the turbine, where you then have the exhaust gas escaping to the top of it, and it then can be directed into a boiler or directed around of the boiler directly into the funnel, which essentially dramatically reduces efficiency. And from this boiler, we then get, from this green boiler, we get the steam, which we can direct to the two steam turbines in the middle in gray. And I don't know what the blue thing on top of it is because I cannot understand and I cannot read Chinese. And from these two turbine generators, or steam turbine generators and the gas turbine generator, we can feed electricity to the main switchboard, the large blue thing on the right, where we can also additionally use an auxiliary diesel engine or a diesel generator, for instance, for use in port when the gas turbine is stopped. And from these, we can then feed probably our propulsion and our remaining shipboard needs on the very right. Point this entire video or this entire thesis is going on about, of course, are the advantages and disadvantages of KOGAS propulsion, and where and how to apply it, where it makes sense, where it doesn't make sense. And for the advantages and disadvantages, we can just look at the various subsystems and other things that we have discussed before and their particular advantages and disadvantages. So, for instance, instead of just using gas turbines, the reason to use KOGAS is that the efficiency equals and possibly even exceeds the efficiency of diesel engines. But on the other hand, the fantastic efficiencies of land-based combined cycle power plants cannot be reached either, because, of course, they are more complicated and just larger than anything you could squeeze onto a ship. And even by just using gas turbines, you would already have the advantages of less exhaust gas emissions due to this continuous combustion at lower temperatures, and especially less methane slip or less methane emissions in the exhaust gas, because of course methane is a stronger greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide, and unburned methane escaping, or significant amounts of unburned methane escaping in the exhaust gas, would offset the environmental advantages of using LNG. And talking about LNGs, alternative fuels like LNG or methanol can be used more easily in gas turbines. And gas turbines and steam turbines also cause less vibrations and noise emissions, which is of interest to passenger ships and probably research ships too. But I expect more restrictions coming in that direction, because the effect of noise and vibration emissions in the water caused by shipping are not very researched yet, but there's some research going on into the effect of these emissions on marine mammals, which probably is not to be underestimated, and thus I expect more restrictions coming in on that topic. Disadvantages of KOGAS mostly are about money, because gas turbines are expensive, steam turbines aren't cheap too. And for instance, Siemens SGT 800 50 megawatt gas turbine costs about 70.5 million, which of course at 50 megawatt only is in the range of large cargo ships, which as of now cost around 100-150 million for the entire ship. So KOGAS would make it more expensive to buy such ships. A problem of all turbines, both gas and steam, is that the efficiency decreases dramatically at partial loads, which is not very good for ships. So far, all KOGAS proposals and a few ships built with KOGAS use at least two gas turbines or two gas turbines. So you can just have one running at full load and one stop that you at least maintain a bit of full load when going slow. The problem is the high speed and low torque, which is exactly the opposite of what you want on a propeller. And because of the gearboxes that would be required, the electric KOGAS with electric power transmission is to be preferred because it just is more efficient than essentially converting 3000 RPM to 150 RPM mechanically. It is more efficient to use generators and motors and transformers. The problems of gas turbines in marine environments is the sensitivity to corrosion and the high air consumption, which just requires accordingly large engine room ventilation systems. All of these, we can conclude that the main reason you would fit a KOGAS plant to your ship is the better application of alternative fuels like LNG or methanol, and the reduced methane slip when burning LNG. But these things can be achieved too by large two-stroke diesel engines, which provide the same advantages at a significantly lower cost. And for that reason, KOGAS particularly are particularly attractive to passenger ships because they cannot use two-stroke engines, and when using four-stroke engines, you would once again emit lots of methane, which is a stronger greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide, and all of your using LNG would essentially be greenwashing and not actually being more environmentally friendly. Passenger ships in general are more expensive to build and have a longer lifespan than cargo ships, which means that the higher acquisition cost of a KOGAS plant has less of an effect, so it won't make that much of a difference to the building price than it does on a cargo ship. And also, because of the longer lifespan, you have more time to get that money back. Talking of getting money back, the smaller engine room increases the free space that you can use for other things, for instance, cabins. And also, the reduced vibrations and noise increase passenger comfort and once again are also better for marine life. Combined gas and steam turbine propulsion has been applied once in the Celebrity Millennium class of four cruise ships, which use two General Electric LM2500 gas turbine generator sets of 25 megawatts each, and a 9 megawatt General Electric steam turbine generator set. So it is a KOGAS plant with electrical power transmission, and everything else pretty much is a bog standard cruise ship diesel electric, or in that case, gas turbine electric plant with two 19 megawatt Rolls-Royce Azipod gondolas or Azipod thrusters, which means an electric motor with a propeller bolted directly to it, and these things can be swiveled by 360 degrees to vector thrust. And this also is the typical cruise ship distribution of about two-thirds power for propulsion and one-third power for everything else. And another very interesting thing is the perfect LNG concept, which was created by a group of companies, including the DNVGL Classification Society, ASEA Brown Boveri Electrical Engineering Company from Sweden and Switzerland, and Caterpillar Solar Turbines, and the French container ship company CMA CGM. And essentially, they designed this perfect LNG, which is an abbreviation for Piston Engine Room Free Efficient Container Ship, which is a 20,000 TEU container ship, which then again, 20,000 TEU is about the size of the largest container ships we have right now. But it is essentially, it uses its size more efficient. And instead of just explaining what is written below, we can just go to the next slide where we can actually see these things. For instance, with the superstructure located at the bow for reasons of the line of sight, but no second superstructure at the stern where usually the engine room would be, because the shafts are moved by electric motors, which can be placed very low in the hull, and then with a lot of space on top of it, that you can just stack containers over it. And the prime movers, in the form of two gas turbines and one steam turbine, are located in the superstructure below the accommodations instead of in the hull, which then frees up space for the fuel tanks, which are located below the forward superstructure, like in all large container ships today. And this, all in all, frees up space in the hull and on the hull for more containers. And additionally, instead of a rudder, it has a counter-rotating azipod, just like in the cruise ship before, which by being counter-rotating reduces turbulence in the water, which then again increases efficiency by about 5%. And this design was presented in 2017 as ready for orders, but since then I have not heard much of it. And I'm afraid that the improvements in two-stroke diesel engine technology and reducing the methane slip pretty much has rendered such things obsolete because, of course, the two-stroke engines are cheaper. But if this thing still comes up, I'm definitely going to apply to CMA CGM. And the only disadvantage I can see, except for the price, is that this thing is unbelievably ugly. But this isn't a real disadvantage, it is just something that I do not like. And another possible application are LNG tankers, of which you can see one right now. And these LNG tankers have been built with conventional steam turbine plants for much longer than other ships, because a part of this LNG, the liquefied natural gas cargo, always boils, and you have to do something with this boil of gas. And for a long time, it was not possible to burn LNG in diesel engines at all, so they just, placed some boilers where everything that burns can be burned, and then being more economical by cannibalizing their own cargo instead of re-liquefying it or just blowing it off into the atmosphere. And the thing about these LNG tankers is that they are very expensive, and they are run much longer than other cargo ships. And for that reason, the idea came up of repowering, just see the typo, of repowering such LNG tankers with a KOGAS plant by, or KOGAS, both is possible, by replacing the boilers with the typical waste heat boilers, and then placing some gas turbines below them. And you have both the option of doing a KOGAS with the gas turbine just driving a generator, or you could actually also place the gas turbine instead of the steam turbine, which was there before, because you already have this large gearbox from the propeller steam turbine being much faster than the propeller too. So you can just use that gearbox and then have the waste heat steam turbines drive the steam turbine generator sets that were built before. And it's always very attractive because many steam turbine powered LNG tankers still are around, and this would essentially reduce the running cost of them and make or keep them profitable for a longer time. And with that, we are also at the end of my video. Well, on the right-hand side, or in the top right corner, you can subscribe as soon as these end card or this end credits things come up. And in the top left corner, you can see my latest upload, and at the bottom, you can see two recommended videos, with the right one being recommended by me and the left one being recommended by the algorithm.